for 6 pence with that quote. Thank you. Today's speaker, Piri, is a leader of the Indian Mount Everest expedition. He is going to give a talk titled Adventure Sport. Let's welcome him with a big applause.
Today I give a small talk on adventure sports. In this talk I like to cover what is adventure sports, how adventure sports are different from conventional or traditional sports, what are the features which makes an adventure sports, types of adventure sports, training, safety, how to get finance to participate in adventure sports. And in conclusion, I would like to have some questions from the audience so that probably I also learn from the audience. This is a two-way communication. When you speak, I am not a speaker. I come here basically, Miss Park and Joey are my friends. They told me, okay, I might be in a very serious accident. My pronunciation may be defective, which probably pardon me. But you can ask me questions, I will be too pleased to answer all your questions. The first question is, what is adventure sport? Adventure sports are activities which involve hazardous action and whose outcome is uncertain. Am I clear? You take part in those activities, but the result is not sure. To give an example, probably tomorrow I am jumping from a high building. It is not sure whether I will land safely or not. Unlike your conventional sports, where the safety factor is taken into account. In adventure sport, the whole concept is that there is a danger to the life. These activities involve a risk to the life. So how they are different from the conventional or traditional or competitive games. These are bold undertakings which involve hazardous action and whose outcome is uncertain. So what are the features which will dictate whether it is an adventure sport or not? First, adventure sports, they are close to nature. All adventure sports are played in the nature. Then, the most important that all adventure activities involve a risk to the life. Then, unlike the conventional sport, there are no rules and regulations for participating in adventure sports. Next, in other adventure sports, you got a fixture or timetable, like a World Cup, your soccer, you have a fixture. Okay, from this date to this team versus this team will take part. In adventure sport, there is nothing known as a fixture or a timetable. Then, in adventure sport, there is no competition amongst the athletes who are taking part. The competition is against the nature only. Since you are taking part in the nature will determine your limitations. So these are the main features which will revolve around the adventure sports. But then the question arises, how these adventure sports are different from conventional or competitive sports. In any conventional sport, you need two teams to compete against each other. In adventure sport, there is no requirement of a team of 11 members or 5 members or 22 members. You can take part in adventure sport even as a solo, as a single man. Tomorrow I plan to do trekking in Mudamsan, I don't need a team. I just pick up my bag and go for the trekking. Then, as I told you, there is no fixture or timetable, like in the World Cup or any. You got a baseball competition, the fixture will come. For this date, team A versus team B. For this date, team B versus team C. In adventure sport, there is no fixture or timetable. You decide your timetable yourself. Today, me and my friend want to go for a trekking. We plan that we will trek in Mudamsan for a week. When reaching Mudamsan, we find the weather is not good. We turn back, or we find the things are very good. Probably we might like to extend it. So you decide your fixture yourself only. You have full liberty to decide your timetable. Then in other sports, there is a dress code. In cricket, probably everybody has to wear a white. In adventure sport, there is no dress code. You can wear whatever you feel like. Then, most important, there is no competition. Me and this boy are taking part, there is no competition between me and him. We have come basically for recreation and enjoyment. So there is no competition between the people who are participating in this activity. Then, as I told you, there are no rules and regulations. In other games, you got rules and regulations. Okay, if you touch, go ball goes outside the field, it is a minus point. If it goes to the goal, there's a goal there only. In adventure sports, there are no rules and regulations. And then, the best part is that there are no spectators. There are no audience. Tomorrow you go to Guangzhou baseball community, there will be two teams taking part and there will be thousands of spectators sitting there and clapping for you. In adventure sport, there is nothing known as spectators. You are taking part in nature, in quietness. I just fail to understand, in any sport, there are two teams involving 22 people. They are fighting for a ball. Type of tricks, pushing each other, and there are 20,000 people who are participating clapping for you. What type of degradation is this? Are we here only to see that this robots taking part in for you? In adventure sport, you decide your own degradation or your own enjoyment. If I like this place, I'll keep sitting there only. If I don't like this, I go away. And there's no somebody to clap for me. You're taking part in nature, enjoying the nature, and then taking part as per your convenience. Then, how to classify? What are the adventure sports? What is the classification? Since I told you, adventure sports are taken part in the nature. And nature consists of what? Your land, the air, and the water. On this basis, adventure sports can be broadly divided into three parts. Land adventure sports, aero adventure sports, which is participating in the air, and the water adventure sports, which are participating in the water. In the land adventure sports, I given only few examples. The list is unlimited. The first is, I think you put full turn, doesn't matter. First is bungee jumping. Are you aware what is bungee jumping? Actually, bungee jumping is not a sport. In Africa, it was a competition between the grooms who want to marry a girl. They have to be taken on the highest point in a tree. And they used to jump. Whosoever can jump successfully without unhurt can marry that girl. From that we have borrowed that bungee jumping. In bungee jumping, now we got cranes, we got cliffs, and we got artificial thing from where people jump and jump with safety. Then we have mountaineering on mountain climbing. If you see in Korea also, all your sages, they used to climb high make a small place for meditation to get peace. In mountain climbing also, we basically do not go to win over nature, we basically go to the mountains to get peace and happiness. When you go to the mountain, when you reach, then nothing is victory, you can't win over nature. Nature is too big a thing to win over. When you reach the top, and when you look down at the people, you will know how big is the nature. You look very small. When I first went to the Everest expedition in 1992, when I climbed, instead of getting very jubilation, I was a little scared. I was scared about my family's welfare and their safety. That also brings closer to the God. Since the distance between God and the top of the mountain is less, you're closer to God. There's total silence, total peace, and your mind is totally fresh. You decide what you want to do. Then we have rock climbing. It is a part of mountain climbing that you go to the hard rocks and do your practice of climbing. Because mountain will consist of snow, ice, jungles and rocks. You ought to have done these things before you go to a higher mountain. Then there is something known as moto track. As the world will know, motor plus track. People who are old or people who are rich, who have limited time, they will like to take their vehicle up to the mountain wherever they can go, and where the vehicle cannot go, they start trekking it. Then we have trekking. Trekking is part of the mountaineering only. When you go to the mountaineering, the first part is only trekking up to the base, and then you start climbing. And this trekking can be as per the terrain. Trekking can be in the jungles, in the desert, or in the coastal area. Then we have something very interesting, caves. Man from prehistoric period did not have a house, they used to live in caves. That's why you find the cave painting, the oldest painting in the world. In India we have many caves where you find prehistoric paintings. In all other countries also. In Korea also we have a lot of caves. Caving exploration is indeed a very, very interesting sport. Then we have skiing. You climb a mountain, now you want to come down, probably you can put on skis and speed up to come down. Skiing can be on the mountain, on the snow. In Australia I've seen people doing skiing, grass skiing. Then we have safari. Safari is basically using the local animal for roaming around. Like in India, we got elephants, we have elephant safari. In a place like Arab, with a desert, there are camels, you can sit on a camel and do roaming around the camel. Then there's a horse safari, that depends. Then is aero adventure sports. Sports which are played in the air, in the sky. Man, when he saw a bird flying, he thought, why can't I fly like that? Man, what is the difference between man and an animal? Man got a brain. Other brain power, he will see something, he'll start deciding, okay, how can I do it? He'll provide something. Same way, first time when a man saw a bird flying, an Italian, he made two big wings by collecting it, put a glue and put that wing and jumped from the Eiffel Tower. The jump was successful. He didn't die. So encouraged, he thought, why not I can go a little higher. This time again he put on those wings, went to a mountain. For those that there were no helicopters, you have to walk. So when he put on those wings, waiting in the mountain, the glue or the wax that melted. So when he jumped, probably those wings flew off and he died. But that gave him a lesson to man, how he can fly like a man. If you have heard about hang gliding. Hang gliding is basically like an animal, like a bird only. You put on those wings and you just copy a bird. How does a bird land? When the bird is landing, you see, it will little tilt it and then land for it. So hang gliding came. Then we have something known as hot air balloon. When as a small kid, you will see when you go to a fair, there are gas balloons. It goes up. So during the war, during the First World War, people with negative mind, I'm also a soldier, so I also have a say, negative mind. They thought, how can we enter enemy country by a balloon? Those days, there were no aircraft. So they invented hot air balloon. You have a big balloon, put something hot, something cylinder, which can give you hot air. When anything is hot, it flies up. But that gave birth to hot air ballooning. It has become a very, very interesting support, where one person has gone round the world in a hot air balloon. You can imagine in a hot air balloon, it's not like an aircraft, where have you control? It depends on the airs. The currents, how many change the place, how many land here, so the hot air balloon. Then we have parachute, which you are aware, a parachute is a big umbrella type of thing only. When you jump, it opens up and then you land quietly. Then you known as something as paragliding. Now what happened, this the parachute earlier was when I was a soldier, when I initially joined, the parachute was very big and very heavy. When you land, you have to roll it up. Again, you bring in the enemy country, rolling them and carrying them is a big problem. So they thought, probably we can have a different type of parachute which is lighter and which you can fly like a bird. So they invented paragliding. Now this normal parachute is round canopy, is a round one. This is a rectangular parachute, which you can, is very light, you can go up the mountain and jump very quietly, and you can maneuver like a car. If you tell me to land at this point, I can land and touch my feet here. Then, the later version, when you saw, okay, this is good, but then you have to, with paragliding, first you have to go to the mountains, all the way. How something which I can fly like a bird and without much effort. So what they did, they took a motorcycle, took out the engine, fitted into a parachute with a small board, it became a paramotor. Paramotor. And then, we have another thing, advanced stage of parachute is skydiving. Normally in parachute what happens, this is not a static jump, your parachute is, the cord is put in the aircraft, when you jump the cord breaks and the parachute opens automatically. But then you can't control much. Then they invented skydiving, which is like your car, it is a square parachute. You jump by, there's nothing hook here only, and then you decide when to open the parachute. So I'm jumping on 12,000 feet, I decide, okay, when I reach, there's the altimeter behind, reaching 4,000 feet, I will pull my parachute, the parachute will get deployed, and I can land safely. So these are some of the aero sports. Then comes water sports, sports which are played in the water. As you know, 3/4 of the area which you are living is full of water, sea, and 1/4 is land only. If you remember the olden days, the Red Indians, they used to do cultivation, they used to go to a place, burn the jungle, make it similarly, sow for one crop and move over. One Red Indian, when he was doing this only, burning them only, he found one big tree which was half on, he threw in the water. And when he threw in the water, that log started floating. So he got an idea, if I can make it a comfortable thing, probably I can sit on that trunk, and then probably I can go in the water. Here, this way, the kayaks, the American kayaks are invented. Basically, they were again made of wooden, make a small hole, a bunny up, a man can sit, have a paddle, and then he can go around in the water. Then a similar thing is your canoeing. The difference between canoeing and the kayak is that kayak is basically used for the sea, and the canoe is used for a flat water in a lake or so. Then we have water skiing. In the snow, we have skiing which we do, put on the seat and slide down on the snow. Same day invented for water. You got a motorboat with high speed, and the person who's with a ski is behind. When he boat pulls it up, he starts floating, and then he can slide down on the water. Then we have something known as yachting. In olden days, people used to do terrain in a ship, and ship didn't have engine, they have only mast or sails. So they used to take advantage of the wind condition, and they used to go to all over the world. The Columbus invented India by sitting on that ship only. So that is yachting. And then we have surfing, windsurfing. Again, these are the few floatable things with a mast, which is used to travel on the water. If this activity is so dangerous, there ought to have some safety to participate in them. No adventure sport can survive, or for that matter, may survive if it is suicidal or if it is risky. If a chap is bound to die, that sport will never survive. That will finish their own. So safety factor is a must. Although I told you there are no rules and regulations, but you have to take some safety factors for participation in this course. If this is so, we ought to have some training. Only then we can learn the safety. So, somebody asked Mallory. Mallory is a person who is believed to have climbed Mount Everest 3 decades before admission. But unfortunately, there is no proof he didn't come back. So when somebody asks, if mountains are so dangerous, why do you climb those mountains? His reply was very, very obvious reply, a spontaneous, because they are there. Man by nature like to have challenges. As a small child also, you always like more of adventure stories where there's some action. As the kids also, you people probably like the action movies. So by nature, man likes challenges. So when he likes challenges, he likes to do something which nobody has done earlier. That you find new adventure activities are coming there. So for safety and training, they ought to have some organization or institute where you can learn. Like mountaineering, there are mountain schools which teach you how to climb safely. Then there are ski schools. For aerosports, there are skydiving schools. And for parasailing, there are parasailing facilities available. All over the world, basically, the military people, they are taking lead. Because basically, they are physically fit. Second thing, the government is paying for this training. But for people like you, young people, when you see those things, you also like to take part in these activities. And this become a fashion. In my days, honeymooning means going to a hotel, going to a garden, and finishing. Now I find young people, they want adventure activities. In my times, when I was doing skydiving, there was a person like me, with turban, I'm an Indian, who married a French girl who was also skydiving. They married in the air. They pass rings in the air by skydiving and they also kiss their women. So everybody want to do something which is unique. For this, there are plenty of places where you can learn all these three adventure sports. Like I told you, for land sport, there are land activities like mountain schools, the skiing school, and for aero activities, there's skydiving federation, skydiving school, and for water, of course, the Navy in the country takes lead, which trains people how to take part in water sports. That is all right, but then these activities are expensive. Then how to get money? How to get opportunity? Everybody is not lucky to join services or rich, but everybody, when you're young, you like to take part. When you see these pictures, you say, why can I take part? For this purpose, every government has a scheme for promotion of sports. And now, earlier, the stress was on the conventional games, the competitive games, but now the government is giving more encouragement to the adventure sports. So many, there are many centers, and also there are private agencies which have opened a training agency. In fact, you find tourist centers, you want to do hang gliding, there are a lot of people who got hang gliding, they like to teach. And for this, like you want to do skydiving, probably skydiving you can't do in the first only. There is something known as tandem parachute, on which two person can, the trainer and the trainee can jump together. Both can sit together and then jump. In Korea, being a peninsula, peninsula means three-sided sea, and on the north you got mountains. It has all the possible weathers, not all the possible terrains. Terrain means they don't have deserts, but at the same time they have all the facilities available. That's why you find Koreans are very good in sports. Basically, for two reasons. First, they hear physical fitness is a fashion. I'm surprised when I come to Korea in this local Mudangsan mountain, Mudangsan, you find more of Harajis and Hanmanis wearing a nice kit and going up and down. Even in front of my house, I just observed ladies, old ladies, 80 years old, they don't like to sit idle. In chair also sitting, they're moving some limbs. So this become a fashion. And in Korea, I find everybody is wearing a very good track suit, which has become, I think, a national dress. My dress, my country, national dress is a long shirt and long. Here I find everybody is wearing a very sportsman like a clothing. This has become a culture. And physical fitness has become a fashion. Every young man doesn't have a tummy. My country find sort of untumi people. Big tummy. If nobody cares. They want a dry fight. But here the food is also very important. The Koreans are very particular about their food. They don't like oil, they don't like sugar, and they like to eat many, many greens that make them totally physically fit. And it's become a fashion. If you keep on sleeping, your proper Harapji will not like it. Probably even with a strict discipline, probably just throw you over. Wake up, go in the morning, do some exercise, look good. In Korea, we got many, many facilities. Just to tell you, just roaming around Korea, I find a very good coastal cycle track all over Korea. More than 400 kilometers, beautifully made track. Then, in Jeonnam-dae University, where I'm a student also, there are a lot of American people. When they heard me talking about skydiving, they said, we also want to do, but then we can't go to India, we're in Korea. In Korea, a place called Daejeon, they got a skydiving school there only. Where can you go do your skydiving? Though skydiving here is very expensive. For a single jump, they charge you $400, which probably is prohibitive. But maybe if some school children or some other young youthfully, the government is there to help you to promote this type of sport, then you can also compensate, give you a scholarship, going abroad, learning this game. The purpose of coming here for me I'm not a speaker, I told you. I'm basically working for Indian Mountaineering Foundation in Delhi. I happen to be a sport lover, where I take part in, before making this accident, my wife is also sitting here with me. I used to take part in a lot of sports. Now I can't. So I'm now looking up only at this station. The Indian Mountaineering Foundation, we are very keen that we have some joint expedition, two countries joining together. So we have brought with the European American countries, but we are not very lucky to have joint expedition in the Korea. Although I came to Korea way back in 92, basically on invitation from Bangkok University, with whom we used to do a lot of planning. So this joint expedition can be very good. First, they can bring two countries together. Second thing, probably the Korean people are advanced people. They have better gear, they have improved gear, probably more tuk-tuk gear. Probably I lack, I can be only physically a little fitter, but probably I don't have that much innovation. So this joint expedition, we would like to encourage. I can give you my email, I can give you my telephone number. If you people are keen to do anything in India, I can arrange. Earlier, my combination with other countries, Americans and European there, the American people bring their own kit, and a kit for me also. I will look after the total local arrangement. Your quarters, your stay arrangement, your food, your transportation, I will do. So that way it's compensated. So if you are keen to take part in these activities, please consult me. I'm part of the GIC. You can always ask my email. And I'll be too pleased to have some joint expedition with some foreigners also sitting here. Are you American? So I'm very keen to have something with the other countries, with Korea in special. That is my reason for coming to this place. So before I go, I have spoken few words like skydiving or base jumping or something like this. Most of the people will not understand unless you see some pictures. Unfortunately, I am not a technical man, but somehow I have still got some video clipping which I would like to show to you. After that, probably you can ask me a question, I'll be too pleased to answer you. This is scuba diving. This is we had a ferry accident where the scuba divers went there and took out the body. This is called adventure. This is mountain climbing. Rock climbing, climbing rock. White water rafting, river rafting. Going inside the cave and exploring. foam suddenly become white. The ribbon of thing was white water.
This begins our question and answer portion of the talk.